In this video, I'll discuss Anton Bruckner's obsession with inverting his thematic material. By this, I mean when a theme is turned upside down so that an upward scale or leap becomes a downward scale or leap in the inverted theme, and vice versa. Bruckner's last six symphonies, numbers 4 through 9, are all absolutely desert island pieces for me, but the sixth is the most unfairly neglected of these, which is why I chose it for this video, and not because thematic inversion plays more of a role in this symphony than in the others. Actually, it's a hallmark of any mature Bruckner symphony. The sixth symphony opens with this pianissimo rhythmic ostinato played by the violins, accompanying this mysterious theme played by the lower strings. The music now intensifies with these upward dotted figures, and notice already these answering downward dotted figures. I'll label these as inversions, but with an asterisk, since they at least resemble the original figure and have the opposite general direction. After dying down to triple piano, we hear a sudden fortissimo repeat of the theme, an almost cinematic moment, now with the timpani hammering the rhythmic ostinato and the horns playing this imitative entry that I'm also giving an asterisk since it more loosely resembles the original theme. Before I point out all the inversions, notice that this symphony is in A major, but its opening theme confusingly has a flat 7th scale degree, a flat 2nd scale degree, and a flat 6th scale degree. In other words, the theme consists only of notes from the mysterious-sounding Phrygian mode, but the accompanying rhythmic ostinato is being played on a C sharp, the raised 3rd scale degree that is part of the A major scale, but is not part of the Phrygian mode. This strange modal duality is what gives this theme its unique exotic sound. In fact, when I first heard this theme, I thought it sounded like something from an Indiana Jones movie, likely because with this raised 3rd scale degree, it also sounds like it's based on the double harmonic, or Arabic scale, used in countless film scores when the setting is anywhere vaguely Middle Eastern. For this same reason, the powerful entrance of the theme we just heard with the timpani also reminds me of the final moments of the famous Danse Bacchanale from the opera Samson and Dalila by Saint-Saëns, in which the timpanist also plays a rhythmic ostinato accompanying this theme that uses the actual double harmonic or Arabic scale, with the raised 7th scale degree leading tone that isn't present in the Bruckner theme.
Thank you.
Returning to this opening Bruckner theme, notice how much it also resembles in overall shape and rhythm this earlier Bruckner theme from the finale of his 4th symphony. Now returning to the 6th symphony, let's skip to the end of the exposition section, when we hear this new orange triplet figure that transitions to the beginning of the development section at letter K. Slightly later in the development section, this figure enters in imitation, but notice that this phase shift effectively creates an inversion of the figure, so I'll label it as such. Now, at letter L, the orange figure and its inversion accompany the inversion of the opening theme. Here's the original for comparison. This inverted theme enters as three-part imitation with this less strict asterisk inversion, and this mostly rhythmic imitation from the bassoon that I'll give a double asterisk. Like in the exposition section, this is eventually answered by the dark blue dotted figures, but now these are also inverted. Listen up to this point and notice that in addition to inverting the original theme, Bruckner also completely changes its character, from mysterious and then intense in the exposition section, to lyrical and cheerful here in the development section. We've made it to my personal favorite moment of this symphony, the brilliant and dramatic arrival of the recapitulation section. The transition is in many ways classic Bruckner, repeating this inverted dark blue figure multiple times over a B-flat pedal point while the tempo accelerates. However, the usual enormous Brucknerian crescendo is nowhere to be found, and instead the sudden fortissimo return of the opening theme, now reunited with the rhythmic ostinato, takes the listener completely by surprise. Notice also the answering almost inversion from the horns, and that we are in the distant key of E-flat major, a tritone away from the tonic key of A major, on the opposite side of the circle of fifths. So, this is really just an extremely convincing false recapitulation, but it allows Bruckner to intensify the music even further with repetitive, imitative fragments of the theme, this time with a crescendo, to the triple forte entrance of the true recapitulation section in A major. Here is my very basic reduction, showing how the tonality moves all the way from E flat major to A major during the false recapitulation. Notice that this penultimate dominant seventh chord coincides with the return of the timpani that have been silent since the exposition section, and that the return of the tonic is even more intensely satisfying with the timpani joining in with the ostinato rhythm. If someone could just figure out how to harness the raw power of this single moment, it might permanently solve the global energy crisis. This intensity gradually dwindles to the quiet entry of the theme in the lower strings. The reverse order of what we heard in the exposition section, now combined with these new figures played by the oboe and flute. And of course, Bruckner can't help himself and inverts these as well. Now listen to this entire spectacular section. Let's skip now to the incredible coda section of this movement, famous for being so tonally fluid that it tonicizes at some point all 12 chromatic semitones. It begins quietly with a simultaneous entry of the opening theme and its inversion, and gradually crescendos as it somehow cycles through all these keys. Eventually, the rhythmic ostinato reappears at the most climactic moment before this sudden triple piano marking. Some commentators have compared this whole first portion of the coda to a sunrise, but I, who for some reason can't escape hearing this movement as a film score, like to imagine it as one of those training montage sequences, during which the action hero somehow becomes a martial arts expert during 30 seconds of constantly modulating and crescendoing music. Now listen to this remarkable coda up to this point, and tell me what you think it sounds like in the comments section.
Thank you.
I stop the music just before the brilliant ending of this coda, when triple piano suddenly becomes triple forte, as this more triadic and triumphant version of the theme enters with its inversion, and the timpani finally reappear to accentuate the ostinato one final time. Notice that after the tonal disorientation those of us without perfect pitch just experienced, this emphatic D major entrance tricks us into thinking D major was the tonic key all along. But only 9 bars before the end of the movement, A major finally returns, though now with the Phrygian version of the theme. Finally, notice that this Phrygian lowered 6th scale degree is suddenly no longer present in the last 3 bars, allowing the movement to end unabashedly in A major. Last-minute return to A major at the end of this movement tricks my brain every time into thinking the movement is ending in the wrong key. I experience a similar effect when I listen to the spectacular ending of the opening movement of Carl Nielsen's 3rd symphony, coincidentally also in A major. I discussed some of this movement's most exciting moments in this prior video, so watch that for more context. But for now, just notice the strange tonicization of F sharp major and minor for multiple bars before the final triumphant emergence of A major, only 5 bars before the end. Back to Bruckner, the magnificent Adagio second movement of this symphony begins with this disquieting theme played by the violins, accompanied by the lower strings playing this descending F Phrygian scale, though the theme itself sounds like it's in B flat minor. A unifying feature of this symphony is that all 4 movements begin with the mysterious Phrygian mode and end with the triumphant, or in the case of this movement, blissful, major mode. As you listen to this opening theme, notice that the last 2 bars of both the theme and its accompaniment are very roughly inversions of the first 2 bars, and when the theme repeats, notice this important counter theme played by the oboe. The inversion of this opening theme appears in this stunningly beautiful moment from the development section. Here's the original theme for comparison. Notice that it's actually entering as accompaniment to this new soaring orange theme played by the first violins, and that it's answered by this imitative entry from the woodwinds. Remember from my prior video that Brahms used this same strategy in the opening movement of his first symphony, accompanying the new closing theme of the exposition section with the inversion of the opening theme. Of course, in these cases, it may not even be accurate to call one contrapuntal line the accompaniment of another, just because it's in a lower register. Case in point, the idyllic second theme of this Bruckner adagio. The score directs the cellos to play this theme prominently, but the answer from the first violins, playing a rhythmically augmented variant of the same figure, seems equally as important. Inversions of the green figure we just heard occur in this movement's sublime coda section, which begins with a flurry of imitative entries of the figure and its inversion over a dominant pedal point. This extended pedal point eventually also includes a pianissimo timpani roll, one of Bruckner's favorite orchestral effects that I've pointed out in both my prior videos about his symphonies. The tranquil, transfigured ending of this coda section reminds me of the even greater coda section from the Adagio third movement of his 9th symphony that I certainly plan to discuss in a future video. The satisfying return to the tonic after this long dominant pedal point occurs with a now completely diatonic major mode transformation of the opening theme with its inversion, leading to one final simplified and rhythmically augmented entry from the woodwinds to end the movement. Notice during this final entry that the original downward scale accompanimental figure is now for the first and only time played simultaneously with its own inversion. Now listen to this entire ethereal coda section. The scherzo third movement begins menacingly with these staccato repeated notes in the lower strings that accompany a complex of interacting motifs. First, these rising pink figures, and then this theme in the woodwinds, and these decorative outbursts from the first violins. Notice that this entire first page strictly uses only the notes of the E Phrygian scale, since the repeated bass notes imply that E is the tonic, and since there are no sharps or flats except in the key signatures of the transposing instruments. An easy way to remember the intervals in the Phrygian mode is to play a scale on just the white keys of the piano starting on E, which makes it even easier to identify the Phrygian mode in the first page of this scherzo. Notice on the second page of the score this slightly different triplet motif that I'll highlight blue, leading to a frightening fortissimo outburst involving the pink rising figures and these simultaneous falling figures played by the trombones and woodwinds. The beginning of this scherzo reminds me of two more famous but similarly foreboding openings that also feature staccato or pizzicato repeated notes in the lower strings. First, the intense opening bars of Mahler's 6th Symphony. And also the opening of possibly my favorite scherzo movement of all time from the Brahms piano quintet. Back to Bruckner, after the first part of the scherzo ends triumphantly in E major, the second part begins with the same repeated notes, but abruptly shifted up a half step to F natural. This accompanies imitative entries of the inverted pink motif, leading also to the inversion of the blue triplet motif on the next page. Here's the original blue motif for comparison. Later in the second section, this blue motif returns again, now combined simultaneously with its inversion. After the scherzo ends triumphantly in A major, the trio begins with this strange pizzicato theme answered by the horns, which in turn are answered by this purple figure. Some of you might have already guessed why I highlighted this figure purple, since it's a quotation of a theme from his 5th symphony that I highlighted purple in my earlier video. If you've watched that video, you've already heard numerous spectacular combinations of this theme and its inversion. But the inversion is also quoted later in this trio from the 6th Symphony. The second half of this trio begins with the green theme alternating with its inversion. And near the end of the trio, the inversion of the purple quoted theme from the 5th Symphony makes its appearance. The finale of the 6th Symphony begins with this mysterious theme. Notice yet again that the entire theme and its accompaniment are using only the notes of the E Phrygian mode, with no sharps or flats. This theme reminds me of the very similar theme that begins the finale of Brahms' 3rd Symphony. Notice that the Brahms theme is also nearly Phrygian, with the exception of these B naturals. Returning to Bruckner. In this final movement, his obsession with inverting themes and motifs reaches a nearly pathologic level. The inversion of the opening theme we just heard occurs as part of this extraordinarily beautiful passage later in the development section. Notice that the cellos play this inversion as accompaniment to this new theme played by the first violins, the same technique we saw in the second movement, and that again, the inverted theme is also transformed in character, from the mysterious Phrygian theme we just heard, to the gorgeous F major of this inverted passage. Part of what makes this moment so stunning is the silence that precedes it, but also the gradual dying away of these dotted figures in the preceding bars. Where have we seen these before? They are actually returning from that oboe countermelody at the beginning of the second movement. This dotted motif from the second movement returns and plays a much larger role in the finale, with many large sections of the movement built entirely from entries of this motif and its inversion. Now listen to just one of these, the section that precedes the stunning passage we just heard. Thank you. Now jumping back to where we left off at the beginning of the movement, the mysterious opening theme builds to this triumphant moment at letter B, consisting of five separate motifs that all reappear inverted later in the movement. First, this yellow fanfare played by the horns, accompanied by this wedge-like chromatic figure played by the strings, and answered by this upward three-note motif played by the trumpets. Notice also this dark blue motif and this answering mustard-colored motif, both played by the entire brass section. Try your best to remember all five of these motifs as we jump to the second theme, a classic Brucknerian Gesangsperiode, or song period, a term used by Bruckner himself to describe his lyrical, dance-like, naive, often pastoral-sounding second themes. Like the one we heard in the second movement, this one consists of two nearly equal contrapuntal lines, but pay attention to this green motif, since the answering phrase begins with its inversion. Here it is juxtaposed for comparison. This section ends with another classic Brucknerian crescendo, consisting of imitative entries of this four-note green motif and its inversion. The crescendo culminates in this fortissimo return of the dark blue motif from earlier, but of course, now the inversion. Here's the original for comparison, and you can see that it's also a rhythmic augmentation. This is played over a quasi-inversion of the orange wedge figure from earlier. Here's the original, and we'll hear the actual literal inversion of this orange figure later in the movement. Before listening to this passage, here's what the original dark blue motif sounded like. Now listen to the later inverted passage. What we just heard was the very first appearance of this red dotted motif in the finale, though I earlier discussed one of its later appearances in the development section. I already compared this movement to the finale of Brahms's Third Symphony, but let me bolster that comparison by pointing out that Brahms also brought back a theme from the slow second movement in that finale. Back to Bruckner, if we jump to near the end of the movement, the inversion of the red motif is combined with a surprise return of the rhythmic ostinato from the first movement, and after a fermata, we hear entries of the dark blue motif now played simultaneously with its inversion. again accompanied by the orange figure. Now jumping backward again, remember what the mustard-colored motif sounded like at the beginning. Later in the movement, it returns with imitative entries in the brass, accompanied by the orange figure. This is immediately answered by entries of its inversion, accompanied by the inverted orange figure. I just interrupted a reprise of the triumphant yellow fanfare, but notice that this time the orange figure is being played simultaneously with its inversion, and that this time the fanfare is answered by a rhythmic imitation. As this forceful passage continues, notice that the yellow fanfare itself is now also combined simultaneously with its inversion. Jumping slightly ahead, the intensity increases as the rising three-note pink motif nearly completely takes over, culminating in a final dramatic inverted entry, followed by a pause, and then by quieter inverted entries. Let's finally jump to the very end of the coda section, when the triumphant yellow fanfare returns with its inversion and with the orange accompaniment and its inversion. The pink rising motif also appears, followed by its inversion, and then at the final climax of the coda, the turquoise theme from the first movement makes a surprise triumphant return to end the symphony. And for one final comparison to Brahms's Third Symphony, remember that Brahms also surprisingly brings back the opening theme of the first movement in the final bars of the finale. Returning one last time to Bruckner, listen to these final bars of his masterful 6th Symphony.